Welcome back to the online sessions on AWP. In the last class, we have computed about the antenna patterns for the various conditions or various criterias with equal magnitudes of currents and phase differences, with equal magnitudes of current with different phase differences. And now today, what we do is we normally go with the next concept of the antenna arrays, which is going to be the n-element uniform linear array antennas. So in this, we have two terms, that is called uniformity, and we normally going to have the concept known as linearity. So here, uniform means what? The different antennas which are placed are normally going to get placed with a progressive phase changes. So progressive phase changes means what? Equal amount of phase changes should simply going to happen between one antenna phase to the another antenna phase in a sequential order. So that is what called basically, you know, uniform phase. What is linearity? Linear means what? The distance between the two antennas, the distance between the adjacent two antennas is going to be same. It is going to be d. If you take d is equal to lambda by 2, all the distances between the various antennas is going to be lambda by 2. If it is going to be lambda, it will be of lambda. If it is going to be 3 lambda by 2, it is going to be of 3 lambda by 2. So like that, we normally going to have the same amount of the distances between the antennas. So when you make such an arrangement, then that type of array is going to be called as an n-element linear uniform type of the array. So this is another type of the array which we normally going to have in the syllabus. And the point P is at the far away distance, at infinite distance, we are going to have this particular point P where we are finding out the electric field intensity. Okay, so now we should find out the electric field intensity at this particular point. So for this, already we discussed about, like, you know, the phase angle, the total phase angle phi, psi is equal to d cos phi. So that means here for every antenna, it's going to be d cos phi. D cos phi is simply going to get added here. So as it is going to be progressive, this d cos phi is going to be similar for each and every, that much amount of increase in the phase between the signals which we apply at these points, A1, A2, A3, A4 should be adjusted or arranged, something like that. When it is really going to be like that, then I can simply call it as a uniform linear array of n elements. So what is an array? Array is going to be a collection of similar elements, is known as a array for us. Okay, so that means here in the case of this uniformity, and next thing is that the elements in the array, that means this A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, all these are the antennas. So we call these antennas as the elements of the antenna. So the elements of the antenna in this particular case should be compulsorily of identical type, because it is going to be coming under the uniform kind of a thing, and the spacing between the antennas is going to be same. Okay, so that is what we normally going to have, which is very important point to be considered when we normally go with this type of the array. Now let us try to come with the mathematical part of it. How do we represent it mathematically? See here, the first one, the first antenna is normally considered as a reference antenna. Now please look at here now. So this is what the arrangement we have now, A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, like this. All these are the antennas which are considered as the elements of the antenna. So when you have more than one antenna, when you have two antennas, we normally going to have, we are represented already for a two isometric point sources we have discussed already, where I have written this as what? E is equal to something like E1 plus E2 or E0 plus E1 we have written. Okay, and we have just computed the expression. Now here we have more than two antennas because it is going to be n antenna elements. If it is going to be only for two point sources, we would have considered only two point sources, but we have got n point sources here. Now among all these antenna elements, the first one is going to be the reference antenna. So since it is reference antenna, I'll be considering the electric field of the reference antenna is going to be E0, and the phase is going to be the zero phase. Okay, therefore I'm writing this as e to the power j 0 plus E0, and the magnitudes of these currents which are flowing through these antennas are all going to be same. Therefore, I'll be writing this as going to be E0, always it's going to be E0 we are writing here. and phases are going to change in a progressive manner. That means first one, it is anyway, it is a reference, so a zero phase. Second one is J psi. Third one is going to be 2 J psi. Fourth one is going to be 3 J psi. So like that, so on up to n number of values we are going to consider. Okay, so therefore, here we are, if you are considering 1, 2, 3, 4, n number of elements, so we will be extending this up to the, on the numerator, on the exponential part of the e to the power value, as n minus 1 we proceed. So this is the mathematical representation of the total electric field at a point P. So this is how we normally represent the electric field equation. Now E naught I can take as common. So if I take E naught as common, so the, anyway this is going to be e power 0, it's going to be 1. So plus e to the power j xi plus e to the power j 2 xi, all these things I can simply go into write. Now in this expression, already we have dealt with this equation. How we have dealt with this equation already? In the previous sessions, we discussed about 2 point sources. Remember, the very beginning, we discussed about 2 point sources. Where it is? Now let us see that 2 point sources. Yeah, this is the case with the 2 point sources. See now, this is the case with the 2 isometric point sources with currents equal in magnitude and phase. So when you take 2 point sources, what is that? You normally, we have normal written for the electric field. We have got one electric field is going to be due to one antenna is going to be E1 is equal to E naught e to the power minus j xi by 2 E naught, because the amplitude of the field component is always fixed or a constant. So therefore I can write this as E naught, and this part is going to be e power minus j xi by 2 e power plus j xi by 2. When you add up these two, what you're going to have now, it is E naught, if I take common, it is going to be e power j theta. It is in the form of e power j theta plus e power minus j theta. If you multiply and divide by 2, I'll be getting into the form of e power j theta plus e power minus j theta by 2. So which is nothing but equal to cos theta. So I can finally write this as 2 e naught cos xi by 2, which is the formula we have. And xi is equal to beta d cos phi. So this is the formula we have discussed and derived in the last class. So when it is going to be the case with only 2 point sources, straight away we'll be getting this in terms of the cos function. So this is the case we discussed for a 2 point sources already. Okay. So this type of array is going to produce a broadside array pattern. Okay. So that's what we have discussed already. Now same thing we are doing once again here, but only for more than 2 point sources. That is only the thing we are doing. So when you are adding for more than 1, 2 point sources, I can expand it something like this. So when you have more than 2 point sources or antenna elements, so the expression is normally going to become more number of terms should come in the electric field equation, obviously, because the number of antenna arrays are, the number of antennas are increasing in the n element array. That's why we slightly deviate, we extend the procedure in a different manner here to get the terms in term, to get the in terms of the exponential components. Okay. So here we have an equation here where xi is equal to beta d cos phi. If there is the phase angle between the two antennas is going to be zero, indicates the total phase difference of the two fields from adjacent sources of point P. At the point P, that means at a point P, two antennas are normally going to radiate the signal with a no difference in the phase, total phase difference, then alpha becomes equal to zero. Similarly, alpha is progressive phase shift between the two adjacent point sources. So the value of alpha may lie between 0 and 180. Okay. The phase difference is going to lie always between 0 and 180. If alpha is zero, then we get n element uniform linear broadside array. So here we are forming a type of array called a n element linear broadside array. If alpha is equal to 180 degrees, we normally going to form a linear endfire array, uniform linear endfire array. Already we discussed this in the previous class. So only thing is we are not considered alpha there, but we are considering alpha. If alpha is going to be 0, it is going to generate a broadside kind of a array pattern. If alpha is going to be 180 degrees, it's going to generate a pattern like an end fire array pattern. So this is what we normally have. Now, let us go ahead now. So here, as we have many phase components are coming in effect now here, what we can just do here is, we multiply with e power j xi on both sides to eliminate this one, to normally consider the complex components. We multiply with e power j xi because many antenna radiations are going to be there. All these antennas are radiating in the free space. So because of that, we just have to consider the exponential notation. We are multiplying with e power j xi. When you multiply another side with e power j xi, don't confuse with this e power j. It is looking like a nu. It is going to be xi due to the printing mistakes and all. It has been represented like this. So now what I can have now, we can just subtract. We have got now two equations. One is this equation, another one is after multiplying with e power j xi. So in these two equations, this e naught is definitely common. So therefore, equation 2 minus equation 1 I can write. Sorry, I can just have equation 1 minus equation 2. So et minus et e xi is equal to, I can write as e naught of, I can write this as what now, 1 plus this e power j xi. Okay, e power j xi plus e power j xi, e power 2 j xi. So like that, I can simply expand this, equation altogether. So this part, e naught part, this first part is what now? E1 plus e power j xi plus e power j 2j plus e power j n minus 1 xi, as it is, I'll write minus of this part. I can write now e power j xi plus e power 2j xi plus e power 3j xi. All these things I can just simply expand. Now once I write this, let us see which components are going to get cancelled out each other. So what components are going to get cancelled out each other here? Let us see now. E power j xi plus e power j xi, here I have minus e power j xi, plus e power j 2 xi, e power minus e power j 2 xi, minus into plus minus. So these two components will get cancelled. Like this, all the components are simply good. All the components are simply going to get cancelled except the last one. Now this is going to produce all the components, like if n is normally going to be, 3, then we'll be end up with the e power j 2 xi, because it is going to be 3 minus 1, it is going to be 2, 2 j xi will end up. 2 j xi, 2 j xi will simply going to get cancelled. And we are going to get here one more extra term here, e power j n xi. So therefore, I can write this as e naught of 1 minus, this part is minus part, so minus e power j n xi. And on the LHS side, I can take ET as common. So if I take ET as common, 1 minus e raised to j xi. So this is the equation I can normally going to get. Now we have to get this in the form of the sine or a cosine format to get the function representation. So therefore, for that purpose, what we are doing, we are just manipulating this equation in order to get the equation in the form of sine component. Okay, that's all we are doing here. Okay, so to get into that form, what I can have here is, I am simply multiplying this equation with the numerator and denominator. Numerator I am multiplying with e power j n xi by 2, and denominator I don't have n here in the exponential part, therefore I am multiplying this with e power j xi by 2. See, when you multiply these two, this is e power something like j theta plus e power minus j theta. These two will get cancelled. I simply going to get 1 over here. And in the exponential part, when these two are going to get added, it's going to be 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 is going to be 1. So it's going to be e power j n xi we get. So similarly, I can just going to have this when you are really going to multiply these two, something like this. So I can modify the equation something like this. So what is the equation for this now? E power minus j theta minus e power minus j e power plus j theta form we have, it is nothing but equal to simple trigonometric relationship minus 2j sine theta. So I can replace this part, entire part, with minus 2j sin theta. So sin theta, what is theta value? Theta is nothing but n xi by 2. I just simply represent n xi by 2. Similarly, the denominator part. So same thing here. We minus 2j sin xi by 2 into e raised to j xi by 2. So that's what. So now this 2j will get cancelled. Minus 2j will get cancelled. I simply going to get sin n xi by 2 by sin xi by 2 into e raised to j. Now I'll take this denominator part to the upside. So therefore I can write this as n xi by 2 minus xi by 2. So if I take j xi as common, I can write this as n minus 1 by 2. So this is what the total effective electric field at a far point P. So this is what you have to derive for the broadside, n element array, n element uniform array. Okay. Now, next concept is going to be what now? Array of n elements with equal spacing and currents in magnitude and phase. So here, broadside array in the examination, if he asks us to explain in detail about broadside array of broadside array, what is the meaning of array? Basically, if you have more than one element in the array, it comes under the array of the antenna elements. Okay, so in that case, we can just simply repeat the procedure whatever we discussed in the previous class for the broadside array. Now, if he is going to be very specific about broadside array, then what you have to do now, sometimes in the exam he is going to ask us list out the different types of arrays. So in the case of that listing out the different types of antenna arrays, what is that we can define them as? We can just simply say as first one as a uniform linear array. We can just simply call it as uniform linear array is one case, and next one is going to be the that is antenna. Uniform linear array is normally based on the spacing between the antennas and the excitation. Spacing between the antennas, excitation, and also the phase angle between the signals. Phase angle between signals which we are radiating from each and every antennas. That is what, based on the uniform spacing, excitations, we are going to have uniform linear arrays. And one more is going to be based on the space parameters. So based on the space parameters, we're going to have the broadside array and a end fire type of the array. So in the case of broadside array, what is the basic broadside array? We discussed in the very, very first beginning class when we discussed about types of arrays, types of antenna arrays, as broadside array, end fire array. Broadside array is normally going to radiate in a direction which is perpendicular or normal to the axis of the array. If the axis of array is on the horizontal direction, radiation is going to be on the vertical direction. So that is going to be type 1 type of the broadside array. What is type 2? I can just think it in a different way also. Like if the axis of the array is going to be vertical, then in that case, the antenna is normally going to radiate in the perpendicular field. That means horizontal. The antenna is going to radiate in the horizontal direction. So therefore, we normally going to have, you know, broadside array of two types, type one broadside array, type two broadside array. And next one is going to be end fire array. In the end fire array, how we normally going to get the radiation? The radiation pattern is normally going to be parallel to the axis of the antenna array in the case of the end fire array. Now with these constraints, we can normally going to have the end fire array and a broadside array. Okay. So here he has considered the entire electric field equation which we have computed in the EMTL subject. So same equation is once again coming here, but you need not write if at all a theory question has been asked. So you can straight away write this in a very short form to represent the equation. Okay. So that means already we discussed about this broadside array, but we have not named it as a broadside array. The very first beginning one, that is what we got it for cos theta. So it is actually for the broadside array. The effective electric field, the total electric field at a far point is equal to what we got as 2E0 cos xi by 2 we have got. Okay, so that is what one of the case with the broadside array, so that the same derivation you can write it by coding some points for the broadside array. So what are the criteria for a broadside array? So in the exam, if he specifies that to explain about broadside array, just simply write down criteria of the broadside array. In the criteria, what are the constructional features, what are the arrangement features of the broadside array, how do we arrange the broadside array. So these points you have to write. So broadside array is always going to be a bidirectional array, is the first design constraint. Next design constraint is going to be always in the broadside array, the maximum radiation is always normal to the axis of the array, is the second one. And elements of the array are equally placed in the broadside array, and elements are equally fed in terms of the currents and the phase. And the phase we apply and the current we apply are always going to be same. That means if you apply the phase of the one of the antenna is going to be, say, imagine 30 degrees, all the signals which are applied to the various elements in the broadside array is always going to be of 30 degrees only, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, like that. It is not increasing progressively. It is going to be 30, 30, 30. It is going to be always same. And magnitude, say, for example, if you are radiating the, say, voltage signal. So if you are applying around, say, 100 kilowatts of power. So all the antennas are going to radiate with 100 kilowatts of power. Are 10 kilowatts of power. So if that is the case, then it is going to be the design criteria for the broadside array under consideration. So you can just code all of them and you can just simply write it for by considering a 2-point isometric sources. Okay. Now this particular derivation has been given for n point sources. So don't confuse between those two. Both are same. Only thing is this equation has been considered for the n number of antenna arrays. When the n number of antenna arrays are going to come in picture, then we are normally going to have a many components in the equation. So we have to consider many components into the equation when we normally going to have the n number of arrays. Now similar to this broadside array, we can go with the end fire array also. So one more thing we're going to have is nothing but the end fire array. So see this array of n elements with equal spacing and currents in each magnitude, but with progressive phase shift is going to be an end fire array. Now in end fire array, almost everything is going to be same, but only difference is going to be that the spacing between the antennas is going to be same, just like broadside array. That means, and the currents we apply, are going to be equal in magnitude for all the elements of the array. That is also going to be same. And phase, in the broadside array, the phase of the various signals we apply to the antennas is going to be same in the broadside array. In the case of the end fire array, it is going to be a progressive phase shift. So because of this progressive phase shift only, we are getting the different direction in the radiation pattern of the end fire array, which is going to be opposite to the axis of the, which is going to be opposite to the direction of pattern of the broadside array. So this is what we have it here right now. Okay.